Okay, so hello everybody. So I have a short presentation on basically a small comparison of latency and reliability for block and sliding window codes. So if you go to the next slide. So one of the sort of key reasons why we introduce FEC or ECC in a system is a sort of an effort, at least in a point-to-point case, to reduce or minimize latency. And if we look at what the most transport protocols use today, which is ARQ or retransmissions shown in the figure on the left there, you can see basically that as packets are flowing through the network, if we have some packet loss, then we basically need to discover that at the receiver. We need to ask for retransmission, and that retransmission has to be delivered at the receiver again. And so basically, we're going to be paying in latency for the reliability with one RTT, one round trip time per retransmission. So this can be problematic for some applications, especially when the link latency or the network latency grows. Certain applications have latency requirements in the order of hundreds of milliseconds. And so if the link latency grows too large, then we don't have time for enough retransmissions, and we need to come up with a different solution for obtaining the reliability but still meeting the latency requirements. So one of the things that is often suggested is using coding for that. And basically shown here in the diagram, right, the nice thing is that we can interleave these repair packets with our normal data packets. Once we sort of, if we experience some packet loss, we can use our repair packets to recover from that packet loss. We can combine that with retransmissions, of course, but we can also run it sort of in a unidirectional way where we just have no feedback at all from the receivers. But there's still some latency involved here. Although this figure is basically seems like there's almost no latency in the recovery, that's actually not the case. So one of the things that I want to share a little bit about today is the latency involved when using a coding approach. So if you take the next slide. So if we start by looking at something which is called block FEC or block ECC, basically what we are doing in those cases is that we are taking our data packets, we are putting them into blocks, and then from those blocks we are generating a repair. So in this figure here, I have two cases. In case number one, we have four blocks of four symbols, and in case number two, we are gathering a larger block which contains 16 symbols. And so if we look at what the repair pattern looks like for those two different cases, if we look at the timeline that we have there at the bottom, you can see in case number one, we are taking our four data packets and then generating two repair packets, then the next four data packets, two repair packets, and so forth, and the process continues. Whereas in case number two, we are collecting the 16 data packets, and then we are generating the eight repair packets. And if we look at the next slide, we can see that the sort of the worst case latency or is the distance to repair, right? So the worst case that we can have is that we lose the first data packet because then we have to wait the longest until we get any repair. The repair rate in both of these cases are the same, right? 33% of the traffic sent is actually repair data. But when we use the small blocks, we can minimize the distance to repair and therefore also minimize the latency or the latency of decoding or repairing packet loss. And the graph there at the bottom basically just shows with a 5 megabit stream and a 1280 byte packet size that the block size really matters when you look at something like latency. There are certain codes that require very large blocks. And what you can see there in that figure is that if you have a block size of more than 500, you actually have accumulated 1 second of latency inside that block. Of course, this also depends on the source, how it's transmitting data, how bursty it is, and all these kind of things. But the block size can really have a big impact on the latency that we're going to observe. And for that reason, we typically want to make the block very small in latency-sensitive applications. So on the next slide, we compared two different configurations, the case one and the case two that we had in the first in the small with the video camera there. And you can see that on the figure on the left, we are comparing the residual packet loss. That is the loss that is sort of still unrecoverable. Given a certain loss on the network, on the x-axis we have the residual packet loss, on the y-axis for the two different codes. And what you can see is that the larger block code, the one that sort of accumulates more symbols before it generates repair, is capable of handling a higher amount of packet loss before it actually sort of has to give up and expose packet loss to the application. Whereas the smaller block code is more fragile because it has less less protection against variance in the packet loss in the channel, basically. But the good thing about the small block code is that if you look then at the latency characteristics, you basically see that for the larger block, the larger Reed Solomon code, you have the blue histogram there. You can see that the per packet delay that we're going to experience with that block code is actually sort of much more smeared out, and in the worst case, we have a sort of relatively high per packet delay, right? Whereas when we use the smaller block code, because we are generating the repair much quicker, we're actually able to cut the tail of that latency distribution by a lot, and we have most of our delay within a very sort of confined region, which is really what we want to have. So one of the things that sort of is interesting to try to investigate is how can we sort of bring these two things together, like get the residual packet loss performance of the big block code, but get the delay or the per packet delay profile of the small block code. And if you take the next slide, so one of the sort of ways that we can do that is by using the sliding window codes that have been also Vincent has done a lot of work on, and just to give you a little bit of insights on how those perform. So just to give you also like a quick overview of how they work, right? If a block code, basically, as I said, what is shown on the right, on the left. Where we're collecting six symbols, then we're generating two repair packets from those six symbols. And then in the next block, we have the next six symbols, and then we generate two repair symbols for those packets. And sort of there's no overlap between the repair and the symbols. They're just, you know, one block is only protected by the repair symbols of that one block. If we look at something like a sliding window code, it works quite differently. But one of the key things that we can observe is that every symbol is actually protected by the same amount of repair. So if you look in the columns, you will see that every packet is included in two repair packets, which is exactly the same as with the block code. But what we're able to do with the sliding window code is that we're able to distribute the repair packets much more granularly inside the stream of the packets that are flowing through the network. And so if we look at the results for a sliding window implementation versus the Reed Solomon implementation on the next slide, you can see that that actually using the sliding window where we have to make it fair, we made the sliding window code only code over 24 symbols. So it's not keeping data inside the encoder for longer than the Reed Solomon code does, but it's sort of sliding packets out of the encoder as they're becoming too old. And what you can see that, and then we have a repair pattern here, which is similar to the small Reed Solomon code, where every four packets we generate two repair. And then we can see basically that previously the 6.4 Reed Solomon code had a worse residual packet loss profile than the larger Reed Solomon block code, but with the sliding window code, it's actually the opposite. Even with the more granular repairs or the more sort of evenly spread out repair, we can actually handle more packet loss before we start to sort of expose packet loss to the application. And at the same time, we are able to get the same latency profile as we had with the small Reed Solomon code. So you can see again the results from the larger Reed Solomon code, where we have a latency per packet latency profile, which is basically spread out, and the worst case is pretty bad. So it means that sometimes, you know, packets experience quite a bit of latency, which causes jitter in the application and all sorts of unwanted effects. But with the sliding window code, we can actually narrow in and cut off that tail, because we're generating the repair needed to deal with losses much more often. So we can basically get sort of the best of the two worlds with sliding window codes. And so I think the final slide is just a quick conclusion on our side, right? So one of the things that you should really consider is that if you're using FEC, ECC, and you have a system where latency is a important parameter to optimize for, you should really consider sliding window codes over block codes. And really, when you look at the behavior of a sliding window code, you will see that sort of in the worst case, it will just perform as a block code, right? And if you want to read some more about sliding window coding, we have a lot of documentation on how they work and different ways to configure them on that link there in our own implementation called Rely. And if you you know want to ask me questions, either go to the list or you can also reach out directly at morten@steinwurf.com. And if you have some questions or feedback for it, I would be happy to discuss.
Thank you so much, Morten. I have comments and questions, but is there anybody else?
There's me.
Okay, please.
So I will sound like the usual broken record. Is there more research being done on this? I went through an NSF group on the future of broadband, and you know, delay and bandwidth are not the only metrics anymore. So I would like to know the research, and also this seems to be, like, I would say it's nice you checked it. But I think we kind of knew that for quite a long time, right? Anybody like me who's done sliding anything in our career know that sliding will be better than block, because you can start decoding as the window arrives and not wait for the whole block. So I'm actually wondering what else is in that research?
Yeah, so that's a super good question. So there's actually a lot of interesting research to be done in this area still. So one of the things that we are looking at right now is that it's actually not true that sliding window is always better than a block. When the repair rate that you have for your sliding window code approaches the losses on the network, the fact that you have overlap in your repair actually means that you can end up in a situation where most of your repair becomes useless, because you're right at the boundary of where the sliding window code is able to sort of, you have a lot of dependency in the repair symbols in the sliding window code that you don't have in the block code, which is sort of, you get a block and then you get repair, and sometimes you're lucky that you get enough repair to deal with the packet loss, but the next block is independent. In the sliding window code, the repair that you currently get might be dependent on another block decode, a sort of a previous window decoding, and that actually can become a problem. So basically, one of the things that we are looking at right now, which is sort of open research, is how you shape the window depending on how close your repair rate is to the packet loss rate that you're observing. And so if you look, and the reason why that is important is that if you look at something like a video streaming application, you can't always increase the repair rate. It's not that you can just bring, like, then you run into congestion, right? There's sometimes where you have like a maximum amount of repair that you can put on top. And there actually, when you reach that ceiling, you need to start to manage your coding window. You can't just include as much as possible. You need to actually shrink it down, and so that you get more, basically you become like a block code. And then you can open it up again as your repair rate actually drops away from the packet loss rate that you're observing. So that's one open thing. Another thing which is currently being looked at is how you manage the coding window when you have heterogeneous links with different latencies. So basically, when you have again, you need to be able to control the coding window in time, and you need to be able to say, so you can imagine you have one link which has 100 milliseconds latency and another link which has 150 milliseconds latency. The packets that you're sending over the slower link, they can't include as many of the source symbols as the other link, because when they arrive, they are 50 milliseconds behind the other link. And that becomes important when you have an overall latency criteria that you're trying to meet. And so I think there's a lot of work that hasn't really been done, especially when we look at the more, bringing it sort of closer to the applications. Last time I talked a little bit about content-aware coding, where basically you have to shape the window according to the video frames. So if you have like if you have a coding window where you're just blindly saying every four packets I create two repair, that's not a good approach. If you have a video frame that's like 15 symbols, because you might have a case where some parts of the symbol of your video frame is not getting repaired until the next video frame arrives, basically. And so you get like a sort of a latency penalty if you don't make your window adjust to the content. So you need basically your repair to follow the content that you are. So this is, again, very application specific, of course, but I think, you know, so that's some of the directions that we are looking at improving this or working on the sliding window codes and sort of optimizing them. But I think that I can mention also a fourth thing, which is basically there's been a lot of work where you either split the solution into ARQ or FEC. So either you build a transport built just on ARQ or you build a transport just built on FEC. There's very little actual transport protocols that try to combine the two, where you actually use ARQ when link latency is low, because then you have time to do ARQ, but when link latency grows, you need to basically switch out of that mode and start to use more the FEC to get some of the repair up front. Yeah, so that's some of the areas
And I think maybe you should mention that in the future. And also, like, you know, we're also looking at research communities here. So you said a lot of we, but is we just you, or is we many more universities? And I will give the floor to Watson after.
Watson, please go.
My question is, impact on the transport protocol of the loss. In other words, how close to the channel capacity is the good put of the channel on the ground?
So, there's a bunch of trade-offs involved here, right? So if you use FEC underneath the transport protocol, you can effectively mask all packet loss. But it comes at a cost of increased bandwidth, right? So when you say good put, do you mean like what is the balance between the amount of repair that I'm putting on my network compared to the actual data that I'm putting in?
Yeah, I mean the actual data the application's transporting. Now, obviously, there's this issue with congestion control, but assuming that you've got a fixed amount of on-the-wire packets you can send, how close are you getting to your channel with a certain amount of loss?
Yeah, so I think looking at the graphs, you can see that the sliding window code is the one that gives you the best sort of reliability overhead trade-off, right? So having the same in all of these cases, they are using 33% repair. So that means that 33% of the packets sent is repair, right? And there you're able to handle, I don't know what is the number here, like the sliding window code can handle 20% packet loss before it starts to sort of expose some packet loss to the application, right? Whereas the Reed-Solomon code is down to 10% or something, and then it starts to expose some packet loss. So clearly the coding that you can use that overhead more effectively with certain types of codes than others. But if you rely only on FEC, you have to have a certain amount of repair in order to deal with a given amount of packet loss on the network. And also how that packet loss is distributed is also has an impact.
Okay, I think we need to stop here. Thank you very much, Morten. Whatever you've said after, well, during the questions for the questions was extremely interesting, and I would be interested in having more detail on this, which is
oh, I'm losing you, Vincent.
Vault. So yes, that's very important. So I hope that next time you will have time to share on this. We tried on our side a few years ago, but we've reached a situation that is not perfect. I was not totally satisfied with the way we initialize such parameters. So if you have more insight on this, that would be great. So we now need to switch, to close the session, the meeting. So thank you very much for all of you. I don't know, Marie-José, do you want to add something?
I was on mute, sorry. I think it was an interesting, I think it was a good meeting. I think it was very interesting. The work is very interesting. It shows that there's still some things that are moving on, and it's nice to hear. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See you next time.
See you next time.
Bye.
Goodbye.